Okay, so tonight we're going to talk about vaccinations. And again, this is a very specific topic, yet at the same time, it's also very broad in that there's a lot of diseases that you can vaccinate for, and there's a lot of things to consider when we start talking about vaccinations, and we're going to talk about those tonight. So what is a vaccine? I mean, it's a word we all hear and use all the time. We've probably all ourselves been vaccinated when we were young and still continue to get vaccines, depending on where we travel or even just getting our regular tetanus shot. Basically, it's something we give to stimulate the body to produce antibodies and provide immunity to the disease. We usually prepare it from that which actually causes the disease or a synthetic substitute. In fact, really when you think about it, vaccines have really contributed so much to our successful way of life these days. Unfortunately, they get a little criticism right now, and a lot of it's unproven. But think of all the things that vaccines have been able to eliminate, both in the human field of medicine as well as the animal field of medicine, and the vaccines that they're working on today that may one day have another huge impact on various diseases. And that includes sheep and goats, too. They're working on some vaccines that I'll talk about a little bit later, that if they were to come to fruition, they would have a tremendous impact on this industry and the health and welfare of these animals. A vaccine consists basically of two parts. The antigen, which is a protein that when white blood cells recognize it, they're going to produce antibodies against it. And then we add an adjuvant, which when added to the antigen, stimulates the immune system to develop antibodies to the antigens. And these are made of all different things, and many times some are more effective than others. Some of them are patented. If you've ever seen the example here in the picture is the Vision CD&T vaccine with Spur. Spur is actually the adjuvant, and of course this company claims that because of the Spur, that vaccine works more effectively than, say, a vaccine that's made differently. So, and it could be more than one antigen, because obviously CD&T is not just one disease, it's three diseases. They're of the same bacteria family, but they're three separate diseases that we can vaccinate for. I wonder do you ever think of how a vaccine actually works? You know, it's like we think it's magic. You give a vaccine, you don't get the disease. Well, it's not that simple. There's things that, question was CD&T, that's going to stand for a couple of the diseases that we're going to talk about as we move through this slideshow. Sometimes I just get lazy and type the letters instead of the actual bacteria or disease names. C and D are overeating disease, T is tetanus. So let's take this sheep right here. Obviously, she looks pregnant, so I'm going to vaccinate her in late pregnancy, 4 to 6 weeks before pregnancy. So I give her an injection kind of in that armpit or axilla area. What happens is the tissue reacts to that injection, to that disturbance, okay? The blood flows to that injection site. That went too fast. I'm going to go backwards. It went faster than I could talk. So the blood... Whoops, I'm going the wrong way. So the blood flows to that site, the white blood cells flow to that site, and basically that's how we get the antibodies produced. That's as simple as how a vaccine works when we initially give it. But it's a lot more complicated than that. Most vaccines are not one-shot deals, and we're going to talk about the different types of vaccine. Go back to those letters C, D, and T. All being clostridial diseases, C and D being overeating diseases, T being tetanus. If I give one shot to that ewe in the last picture, she's going to produce antibodies. But without that second shot, that level is going to be pretty low. So it's that second shot that I give her 3 or 6 weeks later that really boosts that immunity. And then as we go through the year, that immunity declines. And so we give her another booster prior to lambing, late gestation, like we talked about before. Because she's already had her initial course of two vaccines, she doesn't need two this time. And then, of course, she's going to pass that immunity through the colostrum. There's a really good fact sheet. I've got the URL for it here. written by Joe Rourke from Michigan State University, talks about understanding vaccination programs and the importance of timing. And that's where this graph came from, along with another one I'm going to show you. But just keep in mind, it's not a one-shot deal for most vaccines. Okay? The immunity takes time to kick in, and it needs that second shot to really get the high level of immunity. As far as a question about buying a new bottle of vaccine every year, I buy new vaccines every time I vaccinate. I think where it gets to be a problem, and I understand this, is if you only have a few animals. You really should use what's in the bottle, and then get a new bottle. You should, ideally, in an ideal world. One of the things that's certainly going to be an issue as we talk tonight with some of our folks from other countries, we have a few folks from Europe, from Canada, the products that may be available, the vaccines could be different. I know the Canadians have different brand names and combination of vaccines than what we do in the U.S. And in a lot of countries overseas, there tends to be a lot more available in terms of a vaccine. So obviously, we're going to focus mostly on U.S. products, but at the same time, understand that there could be some differences in other countries. There's two reasons to use vaccines. One is to prevent disease, and that's how we generally think of a vaccine. I don't want my dog to get rabies, so I vaccinate my dog. Examples of for the sheep and goats, rabies is an example. The clostridial diseases, which we'll talk about in greater detail, we want to prevent these. Certain types of abortions we want to prevent. And then ammonia, the idea is to prevent problems. We also use vaccines to treat or control disease. For example, and we'll talk about what an antitoxin is, but if I give an antitoxin to an animal, it actually can be a treatment. It can be a prevention too. If I give the tetanus antitoxin at the same time I put a band on that lamb's tail, he's going to get immediate short-term immunity. If I didn't vaccinate, I banded him and I saw signs of tetanus, one of the parts of treatment would be to give him the antitoxin. Might not work, but it would be one of the things that I would do. A couple of the other ones to treat or control: sore mouth, Caius, lymphadenitis, foot rot. I asked a question about which diseases you wouldn't vaccinate for unless they were already present on the farm. That's because some of these, the whole idea is you have it on the farm, so you don't want it. You want to reduce the incidence. And we'll talk a little bit about these specific diseases as we go along. We've got different types of vaccines depending on how they're made. Most vaccines that we're going to use are what we call killed vaccines. They're made from dead microorganisms. This is where our clostridial diseases come in, our abortions, foot rot, CL, rabies. They're killed vaccines. The one that comes to mind that's a live vaccine, and this is extremely important to understand that it's a live vaccine, is sore mouth, because it's made from live bacteria or viruses. Because it's a live vaccine, it's actually problematic and risky when you actually use it. A modified live vaccine, kind of in between, it's a weakened bacteria. An example of that would be one of the bacterial pneumonia vaccines. And then number four, you can make your own vaccines. They're actually, a perfect example is CL. In the U.S., we have a vaccine for CL for sheep. It's approved for sheep and not recommended for goats. Even though we use a lot of stuff for goats that we use in other animals, this is one case where it's highly recommended that it not be used because of the tissue reaction and side effects. Well, sometimes another CL vaccine will be made using, collecting the organisms from animals that have the disease. It's almost like you can make a vaccine from your own animals. Of course, this is going to be done geographically. It's going to be done or on a large farm, that sort of thing. And there's certain companies that will do that. Another way to look at vaccines, two kinds of vaccines, are the toxoid and the antitoxin. The toxoid, again, is that killed vaccine, something like CD&T or the clostridial diseases, or the abortion diseases, or foot rot, a lot of the same ones. If you remember from that graph, immunity does not kick in right away. It takes, I'd say, at least 10 days, 2 weeks, 3 weeks before you're going to get any immunity. But you're in for the long haul. You give that second shot at least 10 days apart. Usually it's actually spread out a little bit more than that. And it's only after that second shot that you get a real high level of immunity. And it's going to last a lot longer than the reverse, which is an antitoxin. And again, it's with the idea of preventing a disease from occurring. There are certainly toxoids that we use in other ways, but for the most part, we're looking at trying to prevent a disease. And again, you see all the examples of what would be a toxoid. An antitoxin is, again, it's sort of like the live, it's you get immediate immunity. As soon as I give that shot, I'm going to get protection from tetanus if I give the tenth is antitoxin. But that immunity is going to be short-lived. That short-lived immunity may be enough, though. A lamb or kids at high risk, if we ban them, either their scrotum or their, in the case of a lamb, the tail. Once we get them past that risk period, they're a lot less vulnerable to tetanus. So that tetanus antitoxin in the short term just might get it done. Also, again, it's used for treatment. If you didn't vaccinate and you see signs of some of these clostridial diseases, you can give the antitoxin as a treatment. Will it work? Maybe, maybe not, but it's certainly going to be one of your best chances of treating some of these diseases. One shot. It's a one-shot deal. And we use it to both treat and prevent. Tetanus antitoxin is a perfect example. I give them an antitoxin. I ban the tail. I'm trying to prevent a problem. I didn't give them the antitoxin. Didn't vaccinate the mom. I banned them. A week later, it comes down with symptoms that look like tetanus. I give them the antitoxin to try to treat them. So I can use it to both treat and prevent. So what can we vaccinate sheep and goats for? The clostridial diseases, and we're going to focus on those. It's a big group of diseases. Sore mouth, abortion, caseous lymphadenitis, foot rot, bacterial pneumonia, rabies, autogenous, I don't know, even know if I say that term right. Again, those are the vaccines that you can make from the isolated organisms from animals that are sick. Other, that's my catch-all. There's some differences in other countries, and there's also some vaccines in this country that aren't used or used geographically or aren't recommended that we'll talk about a little bit. And what about the future? What might we have a vaccine for in the future? And what are researchers and scientists working on? And they're probably working on far more than I know about, but I want to focus on one. Clostridial diseases. The thing to keep in mind about these diseases, they're anaerobic bacteria. They occur widely in nature. Doesn't mean all of these bacteria are on your farm, in your barn, but they are bacteria that widely occur in the environment. And where they're a problem can vary. Anaerobic means they're bacteria that do well where there's no oxygen. That's why banding increases the risk of tetanus, because the band creates an anaerobic environment underneath that band. And that's why bands have always been considered the highest risk for tetanus. You don't usually introduce these diseases, they're there. They're there. They're something we have to, kind of like worms. A lot of them are something we just have to live with and learn to manage. The primary ones are what we call the enterotoxemias. Think of them as the overeating diseases. They're the things that affect the digestive system. We've got five of them, A, B, C, D, and E. I think most of you, you know, getting back to what was C, D, and T, the C and D is those two types of clostridial diseases, type C, type D, are the most common in sheep and goats. The other within this list that's going to be the most common or the greatest risk is going to be tetanus. The rest of those diseases, I'm not going to say they couldn't be a problem on somebody's farm, including the A, B, and E type of overeating disease, but more than likely you're going to find out from a diagnosis. I added the one at the bottom, which is basically botulism. Botulism is one of the most deadly clostridial diseases in the world. I don't think much of it when I think of livestock, but one of my dairy farmers that provides my hay actually had not only did he have a niece with botulism, but also cattle. So it is possible for them to get that as well. Okay, sticking with the clostridial diseases. Again, it's going to vary, but for the most part, that C, D, and T, the overeating disease, the two types, C and D, and tetanus, they're the ones that most commonly affect sheep and goats. Typically, we vaccinate cattle. We might have a different mix of vaccines, but these are the ones that most commonly affect sheep and goats. And even in my travels to different parts of the world, this is really the only universally recommended vaccine for sheep and goats. A little bit of differentiation between C and D. Type C primarily affects lambs and kids that are going to be under a month of age. It causes a bloody diarrhea, a hemorrhagic enteritis. That's the first picture of the black-faced lamb. These pictures all came from the UK. Type D is more what we think of when we say overeating disease, this would be our classic overeating disease. The lamb in the middle, often this is the exact symptom you see, dead. Just a dead animal, a sudden loss. It affects the best growing animals that you have. Type D tends to affect the older ones. We call them overeating, not necessarily because the animals overeat, but it typically, what predisposes them to these diseases is all of a sudden they've got a higher plane of nutrition. Whether that means they were on grass and they came in and got all the grain they wanted, or maybe it was a litter of two lambs and one of them died and all of a sudden that other one gets a lot more milk, or say they were on creep feed and the creep feed ran out yesterday and then you give them more and they gorged on it. So that it's kind of like it's predisposed by going from a high to a low plane of nutrition. The bacteria is always in their gut, and that's why I say it's kind of like worms. It's always going to be with them. Tetanus, of course, the lamb on the right, lockjaw, stiffness, can affect sheep and goats, people, animals, mammals of any age, but we consider the highest risk period to be at the time of docking, castrating, and disbudding, especially if the rubber rings are used. Because we're looking at tetanus when you have a wound, you have an opening into the body. Think about when we were kids, if you stepped on a nail, your mom would say, hey, you need to go get a tetanus shot. So it's a wound, and it can happen at other times, but we consider the highest risk period to be during when we process these lambs and kids. And of course, if we give them the toxoid, we're starting them out on a long-term immunity, not just that short-term immunity. Okay, so that's what I mean by C, D, and T. And now, well, how should we apply this vaccination program? Well, let's look at the U's and does first. We want to pass immunity on to the babies, so we need to vaccinate mom. So 4 to 6 weeks before lambing and kidding, and that's why it's important to kind of know when the lambs and kids are due, is when we want to give them the toxoid. Not the antitoxin, but the toxoid. And they'll say C, D, and T right on it, and it'll list the actual names of the bacteria, Clostridium perfringens, type C and D, and tetanus. We want to do the U and doe for two reasons. We want to provide immunity to her. This time of year, she's most likely to get grain. The most feed she ever gets is going to be this time of the year, so it makes sense that we improve her active immunity to overeating disease. We also want to pass it on to the offspring, so we want to do mom so that the immunity passes through the offspring through the colostrum. Couple of things to consider though. If you never vaccinated your ewes before, does before, or you don't have any idea, you'll need to do it twice that first year. The first time they ever get vaccinated for something, it needs to be twice. About 4 and 8 weeks apart. So I do it 4 and 8 weeks prior to lambing and kidding. You don't want to vaccinate within 14 days of when they're due because that's not long enough to put immunity in the colostrum. And then the other thing to keep in mind is the immunity may not last as long in goats. It may not last as long in goats. Some veterinarians actually advocate vaccinating goats twice a year. Not because you're necessarily putting it in the colostrum twice a year, but to protect the actual doe and buck. We got a couple of questions that I want to go ahead and handle. How does one handle this with a mixed group of does in different reproductive periods? Really hard. The only way you can do it is separate animals. That's, again, one of the advantages of the more uniformity you have, both in size, production, and timing, it makes it easier. Otherwise, ideally, you want to make the best separations that you're capable of making. Can you over-vaccinate? you can over-vaccinate from the standpoint of you don't need to do something and you're not accomplishing anything. You're spending extra money, spending extra labor, causing extra tissue damage. So I think from that standpoint, yes, you can over-vaccinate. And those would be the type of problems that you would cause. Will the passive immunity protect lambs when docked? Yes, and we're going to talk about that. So this is what we do with the ewes and the does. We vaccinate them prior to lambing and kidding. One of the biggest downfalls of keeping a buck or ram in year-round, if you don't know when they're due, you really don't know when to vaccinate. And it's a challenge. You can try to estimate by looking at udders, or you can see, well, I keep the ram or buck in all year round, and he usually starts having babies in the middle of January. And you can kind of use that basis. Oh, and I always want people to remember, we focus on the ewes and does and figure, well, the ram and the buck did his job and we don't have to worry about him. But they should be included as part of an annual vaccination program. The bucks, the rams, and any weathers that you have around. They still should be part of it. Even a pet weather, somebody that's just got a few pets, particularly if he has any access to grain or something like that, it's a good idea to protect him. And it's easy to do. Okay. Now let's move on to the babies. Well, the babies their moms have been vaccinated, so we want to start them on their course of vaccinations when they're about 6 to 8 weeks of age, and then a booster when they're 10 to 12 weeks of age. And the reason for this, and I'll have a graph that shows you, at about 4 weeks of age, that immunity that they acquired from the colostrum, and I'm assuming they drank enough colostrum, it starts to decline. And it's completely gone by the time they're 12 to 16 weeks of age. So this idea of doing it 6 and 8 and 10 to 12 kind of keys on that. If you give it too much earlier than 4 weeks, you're going to get some immunity, but you're not going to get as good immunity. For two reasons, the immune system of those young animals is still developing. And you've got the interference of maternal antibodies. There's a real interesting study that Cornell University did a couple of years ago, and they compared different timing of vaccinations, and that they found that when they vaccinated, like baby lambs, I mean, coming right in the jug, just a day or two old, they didn't get any immunity. They didn't get any. So you got to keep in mind, the best course of action is to vaccinate mom. Vaccinate mom. And then when you dock or castrate within that first 4 weeks, and you really should do it within the first week of life, they're covered. They're covered, okay? Here's a graph that shows it to you a little bit better. So that part in the gray area, that is the protection that these lambs and kids got from the colostrum. Again, we're assuming they consumed enough colostrum. Big assumption sometime. And could it be different for kids versus lambs? I think it could be, because we already know that the vaccine doesn't seem to work as well in goats as far as the adults. So there probably, possibly could be some differences in kids. As those of you who raise goats know, there's a whole lot more data on lambs and sheep than there are on goats. And all we can do is go with the data we have from sheep and maybe just keep that in mind. You know, I wouldn't wait till 16 weeks, for example, on either species to make sure that these lambs and kids got protection, particularly if they're creep fed. A question about the price of vaccine. That's going to be pretty dependent on what product you use, where you're at, and even though you might only want to buy vaccine for 10 animals, you're going to have to buy vaccine in certain amounts. So I guess that's my cop-out answer, but it's going to be highly variable. Everybody knows in the real world we don't always get everything done. That maybe I didn't get around to vaccinating the moms because, oh, it was right during the Christmas holidays and I didn't feel like it, or we had lots of snow. And we do have lambs and kids that don't get any colostrum, or maybe they didn't get enough. And so they're not going to be protected when they're born. Or when they're a couple of days old. So the thing to keep in mind is the only way to protect for type C overeating, that hemorrhagic enteritis, is to vaccinate mom. Because if you vaccinate that couple-of-day-old lamb and kid, again, unless you use the antitoxin, it's going to take time to develop that immunity. It's going to take a second shot. And then you got the fact that it's a very young lamb, and the immunity doesn't really, doesn't really kick in. What you can do, and I've already mentioned this, is if you didn't do mom, you can go ahead and give the antitoxin at the time of docking, castrating, and disbudding. Immediate short-term immunity. And then start them on their course when they're, say, 4 and 8 weeks of age, on their initial course of there was a question about market animal. What we're not vaccinating always for the long-term life. We're vaccinating them very often to get them to slaughter. If I have lambs and kids that I'm going to probably sell when they're 4 or 5 months old, and I'm going to feed some grain into them especially, or I have some really lush pastures, yes, I should put them through a vaccination schedule. The withdrawal period for meat for most vaccines is 21 days. I have a guy that picks my lambs up at weaning, and very often I give him that second vaccine kind of right about that time. And one year he forgot to tell me that he was going to send some directly to slaughter, and I had already vaccinated him, so he had to hold off 3 weeks. So just keep in mind, it's about a 3-week, 21-day withdrawal period for these CD and T vaccines, and actually for a lot of the vaccines. And it'll always be on the label, especially if it's, well, it'll always be on the label. In the event of a disease outbreak, again, you think you might be having type C overeating or tetanus, this is another place that the antitoxins would come into play. So it's not the end of the world if you didn't vaccinate mom, but there are some adjustments you can make, but ideally you'll get mom vaccinated. My problem isn't always that I don't get mom done. My problem is I don't always get that second vaccine into the lamb. What about the 7 and 8 way clostridial vaccines? Particularly the one you hear about is called Covaxin 8. Many people do use this. My thought is that if my flock is at risk, I would consider using these multi or 7 or 8 way vaccines. I know my situation, these other clostridial diseases are not a risk on my farm, so I use the basic CD and T, but if working your own situation and maybe working with a veterinarian, if that's the logical thing to do to use this type of vaccine, I certainly would. I can't speak for all regions of the country or all parts of the world, so there may be some cases where this would be warranted. It's very similar protocol as CD and T. It's a larger injection in terms of the volume, but very similar. Question about vaccinating when you turn sheep or into the buck to be bred. Not for CD and T, but if you were vaccinating, and we'll talk about this, for any of the abortions, those are pre-breeding vaccinations. But in terms of CD and T, this focuses in late pregnancy, so we can pass that along to the offspring, and then we begin the offspring on their course of vaccinations. Leading us to what else can we vaccinate for? And this goes back to that other slide. I just took away the clostridial diseases, because again, they're really the only universally recommended vaccine is to vaccinate for either CD and T, the three that are the most common, or if there's a reason why you need to extend it to the 7 or 8 way, that would include that as well. Here's some other things you can vaccinate for. Should you? Depends. We're going to go through each of these. The first one is sore mouth. Sore mouth it's not like the bacteria, it's caused by a virus. It's the most common skin disease in sheep and goats. It's not like that virus is everywhere, but yet at the same time, I'll say it is something that's very widely dispersed in the sheep and goat industry. We have a goat test at my research center. I guarantee we're going to get it every year because we bring in animals from all over the place. We don't worry too much about it. My own farm, I've never had sore mouth, and I doubt I ever will because I have a closed herd. And then we got everything in between. Sore mouth is one of those diseases that you do not want to vaccinate for unless you already have it. Because basically, you're using a live vaccine, you are giving it to your farm. So you would vaccinate if you already have it, you've already had it, or you're at really high risk. You show, you exhibit, you consign. We're going to recommend that our consigners to our buck test vaccinate for sore mouth. You know, just as a precaution. Not because primarily because so it won't set them back. Swimmouth doesn't kill sheep and goats. It's very rare that it does that, but it can set them back. And our test is about performance, so the last thing you want is your animal to be set back. It's just a protection if you already have it. It's very different. It's not an injection. You actually apply it topically. You scarify an area where there's no hair, where it's a protected area, and you apply the vaccine to it. So you do it at a, you're basically giving them sore mouth where you want and when you want. It is safe for pregnant females, but think about it. You don't want to give it anywhere near the udder, like the flank area, because the last thing you want to do is put sore mouth on the udder. There's some evidence that you'll get some immunity to the colostrum. A couple people have made a couple of comments, as you see in the chat. The sore mouth vaccine doesn't cover all strains. Certainly not. You know, you can have, nor does it prevent them from ever getting it again. It's just more than likely they won't get it again, but if they did get it again, they'd probably get it as badly. What's more typically done is the kid or lamb crop is vaccinated. If you're going to show, you want to do it at least 6 weeks before the show. You want to give it long enough for the vaccine to give them sore mouth and for it to run its course, because that's basically what sore mouth does. But it's a live vaccine. You need to be careful. It is contagious to people. Knock on wood, I've never had it. I heard people have had it before. It can be quite painful. I even know a little bit of a bad situation that happened at our state fair. When you give the vaccine, you need to wear disposable gloves. You just need to be really careful. But it's something that, again, this is something you don't want to vaccinate against unless you already have it. Almost sounds crazy. Well, why do I vaccinate? I already have it. Because vaccines are not only used to prevent, they're also used to treat, and they have a much wider use than what we might have think is the traditional vaccine. Okay, foot rot. This is another one of those that really there's no sense in vaccinating unless you have foot rot. Keep in mind, foot rot is caused by two anaerobic bacteria. One of those bacteria is there if you raise sheep or goats, no matter what. It's in the manure, it's in the soil. If the conditions are right, you can get foot scald. Foot scald is when you get that kind of redness between the two claws of the hooves. Doesn't get into the hoof tissue. It's between the toes. Looks the same as foot rot because you see limping animals. It takes the second bacteria to actually get foot rot. And that bacteria can only survive for so long in the environment. Mostly it survives in hooves, in air pockets in hooves and that sort of thing. So you want to only use this vaccine if you have a history of foot rot on the farm. Just like was mentioned about the sore mouth vaccine, it does not cover all strains of foot rot. It's not going to get rid of foot rot. It's one of those vaccines that we use so that we can reduce the incidence and severity of foot rot, kind of using it as a part of a treatment plan. The timing of the vaccine is to do prior to those risk periods, much like CD&T. We're going to do it in proper timing. So the most likely time they're going to get it is when it's wet. Okay, abscesses are pretty common at the injection sites. In fact, as most of you probably are aware, abscesses are not that uncommon with vaccines. And some products seem to create more abscesses than others. I'm involved with a foot rot project at the University of Maine. In fact, anyone who has foot rot that would be interested in eradicating it in 4 weeks, and it does include genetic testing, as was mentioned in the chat box, we actually, as part of that protocol, do not recommend the foot rot vaccines. There's two of them, FootVax and FootVolar, I think is the other one's name, but we don't recommend it as actually part of the treatment. And one of the reasons is because it doesn't cover all the strains of foot rot. There's a lot of basic stuff that's going to do you far more to get rid of foot rot: hoof trimming, proper hoof trimming, foot soaking, culling. Those are the key things to get rid of foot rot, but there is a vaccine, just so you know that it does exist, and people do use it. Saying more about genetic testing for foot rot resistance, there's certainly scientific evidence to suggest that sheep can have, and I presume goats, but I know the work's been done with sheep, have resistance to certain diseases, and that would include foot rot. internal parasites, there's lots of them. And of course, we look at those kind of things on the big scale first. You know, we select animals within our flocks that won't get these diseases. But eventually the scientists narrow it down to individual genes. And that's where this testing for foot rot or lots of different things would come into play. That's kind of the future of when you think about the genetics of livestock, is not looking at it from a herd standpoint, not selecting within your herd or flock, but actually doing a genetic test for it. And the foot rot project that we have up in Maine, we're going to try to do a little bit of that. It's going to necessitate working with some of the same breeds. And as far as it commercially available in the U.S., I don't know. Maybe Bill might know the answer to that. Something. Caseous lymphadenitis, CL, cheesy gland abscesses. Interestingly enough, the buck in this picture did not have CL, but sure looks like a classic picture of CL. Somebody made a comment about Angoras being sensitive to foot rot and scald. Makes perfect sense because Angora goats, goats in general, boar goats, they come from a dry climate. And so a lot of the things, a lot of problems that moisture bring are more likely to happen to the animals that didn't originate in a wet environment. Parasites, hoof issues, pneumonia, anything that moisture brings. So it makes sense to a large degree that Angora goats might be more susceptible to it. CL is another one of those things that you only vaccinate if you have it. Again, it sounds kind of crazy, but the idea is to reduce the incidence and severity of the disease. A lot of folks out there, and I'm not so sure I don't agree, is if you have it, get rid of the animal. Now, if you have a small flock or you have animals that have sentimental value, obviously you can't necessarily do that. But from a commercial standpoint, if it has an abscess, you should probably get rid of it. Well, I should say if it has a CL abscess. This particular goat in the picture was in our goat test. We have zero tolerance for CL in the goat test. We lanced this abscess, tested the pus. He did not have CL, so he went back into the test. This year we tested a goat. He had an abscess back on his hindquarters. He tested positive for CL, and he left the test. So you can do it that way. An abscess doesn't mean it's always CL. You can test it, but if it does have CL, if it doesn't have sentimental value to you, you really ought to consider getting rid of it. The CL vaccine often comes in combination with the clostridial diseases. It's like CD, and I forgot the initials they use, but it often is in combination, so therefore would be used in combination with that. It's definitely not recommended for goats. I'm sure it's been used for goats and maybe even been used for goats without significant problems, but the company will tell you not to use it for goats. They can have pretty intense tissue reactions to the vaccine. I've actually even heard of sheep having some problems with the vaccine. And probably if I went on a vaccination program, I would probably want to work with a small ruminant veterinarian to make sure I'm kind of need to do it and I'm using it in the right manner and kind of have a complete program for how I just deal with this disease. As far as there are certain companies that will develop vaccines. I don't know off the top of my head, and I don't know within other countries, but there are companies that will make vaccines that are more specific than, say, just the commercial ones that are out there. We can vaccinate for a couple of the we can vaccinate a couple of the diseases that are common causes of abortion in sheep and goats. I'm sure the vaccines are not approved for goats, so again you'd want to work with a veterinarian. There are two vaccines that are approved for sheep: the one that causes chlamydia, which we call enzootic abortion, and Campylobacter, which we call Vibrio. I would only vaccinate if I had a problem. I had those diseases diagnosed. If the risk of abortion was high, I bought females from an infected flock or a flock known to have abortions. Anytime I have an open flock, obviously risks are higher. The risks are also higher with the ewes that have never produced lambs. Because generally speaking, when a ewe aborts from these, she's immune after that. This is the vaccine that you give before breeding. Someone had asked a question about turning animals in with the males. This vaccine is given before breeding. Obviously, again, two shots are needed that first time. One of the other common causes of abortion in the U.S. is toxoplasmosis. That's the one. I'll work harder on speaking up again, appreciate you letting me know if you're having a problem hearing me or if it's breaking up. Sometimes I might not be able to do things, but sometimes, again, I get a little relaxed and may stop talking so loud. We don't have a vaccine in the U.S. for toxoplasmosis. I do know vaccines exist in other countries in Europe, but not for us. Salmonella is probably a distant fourth in terms of causes of abortions in sheep and goats. There's cattle vaccines, none approved for sheep and goats. Again, this would probably be something that, were it diagnosed, you would work with a veterinarian or a diagnostic veterinarian maybe to have a vaccination program. Bacterial pneumonia, this is, again, not something I would routinely do, but I'd consider it if my flock or herd experiences high losses due to pneumonia, it's diagnosed, and the cause of pneumonia is bacterial, not environmental. We can cause an awful lot of respiratory problems simply by having poor environmental conditions in terms of ventilation and that sort of things. So here we're talking about bacterial pneumonia. That's the only way a vaccine is going to be effective. There is a Pasteurella vaccine labeled for sheep. Sometimes the cattle vaccine, Nasalgen, it actually goes into the nostrils, is sometimes used on sheep. And I presume both of them may occasionally be used on goats as well. Questionable efficacy. I've read a number of studies, or at least several studies, on both of these products, and they question whether they had any impact at all on the level of pneumonia in the particular flock that they tested. But it is a possibility they do exist. Rabies. I wouldn't routinely vaccinate for rabies unless it's required. I believe increasingly to show livestock, you may have to vaccinate for rabies. We do not require that in the state of Maryland yet, but it is probably coming. If your risk is high, I tell people if your animals are going to have access to the public, this could be fairs, shows, or festivals, it might eventually be required. If you're going to bring people to your farm, like have a petting farm as part of a farmer's market or something, I'd highly recommend vaccinating for rabies. If you're going to be leasing out animals for grazing, targeted grazing, in the public might somehow have contact with them, I would probably also vaccinate for rabies. A lot of this is just to let people know you're doing everything possible and kind of to cover your liability. And then just like any other vaccine, it's a method of managing risk. And you have to look at your individual situation. Do your livestock have contact with wildlife? Do you or your children have a lot of contact with their livestock? Do you have animals that have especially high value economically or even sentimentally? Bill Duffield just mentioned that people can be vaccinated. We've all heard horror stories about if you have to be treated for rabies. Another dairy farmer that has supplied me hay, he shared with me the fact that not only did his cows have got rabies, but he had to go through that vaccination. So it's been getting me to think more and more about possibly vaccinating, maybe even just to protect myself. Okay, a couple of other things that are out there and possible, but probably not something most of us are going to do. Epididymitis is a disease that affects the, it's caused by brucella. Brucellosis is the more common disease you think about. In sheep, it tends to affect the epididymis, which is kind of the part of the scrotum that goes around the testicle. It gets real big. It affects their fertility. It's contagious. But from what I read, it's not generally recommended that you vaccinate for them. And just like some of the other vaccination of diseases that you actually want to eradicate, it will mess up if you blood test for it. If you blood test for it and you vaccinate, you know, those two things don't go together. Blue tongue is a viral disease with an insect vector. We do have it in the United States. It does vary geographically. The vaccines that we have don't necessarily cover all the different strains. And I'll basically say it's not commonly given, but it does exist. As far as who would give a rabies vaccine, in most cases, this is something the veterinarian would give. I'm not going to say you can't figure out a way to buy it probably. There is a vaccine for sheep that's approved. There is none for goats, but obviously that vaccine is probably given to goats. But it is something that you should probably at least check with your veterinarian on. And certainly if you want to be able to say you did it, you know, whether we're talking about taking them to a public event or having them on a farmer's market, if you want any credit, the fact that they've been vaccinated, you would definitely want to go through a veterinarian. We actually do have anthrax vaccines available. Again, something that's not used. Foot and mouth disease. Obviously, the U.S. is foot and mouth free, but we do have a vaccine bank. So, but we're not going to use it because we'd lose our free status. But in other countries, it's certainly done at times. As far as I know, Australia is the only country that has a vaccine for Yoni's disease. I could be wrong. It's not available in the U.S. In fact, I don't even think we're properly addressing the possibility that Yoni's is more widespread than we think. So those are other things we could vaccinate for, not likely to. There could be some special circumstances, however. Every farm is different. What are scientists or companies working on? I'm really excited about the first one. They are working on a vaccine for the barber pole worm, for roundworms, nematodes, stomach worms, whatever you want to call them. The vaccine was developed in Scotland and the UK. They're currently doing trials in Australia. And the biggest grant ever awarded in animal health in the European Union is to develop vaccines for gastrointestinal parasites. So it's pretty exciting that this is underway and that the early results are looking pretty darn good. A number of years ago, we had a scientist working on a vaccine for the meningeal worm. But I think it kind of got dropped a number of years ago. Of course, they were looking at it for llamas and alpacas, but if it worked for llamas and alpacas, it's likely to work for small ruminants. Meningeal worm is what we call the deer or the brain worm. Sheep and goat, along with camelids, serve as an unnatural host, and it's a very difficult parasite to control or to do anything. As far as the worm vaccination, if it comes to fruition, it's something that it's not a one-shot deal. It's something that you do repetitively, almost like, my understanding is almost like deworming. Deworming in the old days, where you might actually do it repetitively. As far as the exact science of it, I'd have to get back to you on that. I've read about it, but I probably didn't retain it. I just think the whole concept is pretty exciting. Vaccines. Now let's talk about what we do and don't do with them. One thing is always follow the label. Always. Most vaccines, not all, are subcutaneous injections under the skin. Clean needles, syringes, that's kind of a no-brainer. If you have a small flock, use a clean needle for every animal. They're disposable. They're cheap. If you have a larger number of animals, that's not real practical. If you're using some type of automatic vaccination tool, change it every 15 to 20 animals. Don't use real big needles. In reality, we want to use as small needles as possible. It will do less tissue damage. When we're drawing vaccine out of the bottle, don't take the shot that you just put into an animal and put it into the bottle. Use a separate needle for getting the vaccine out of the bottle. Store vaccines properly. Heating and freezing can ruin them. Don't allow them to reach room temperature. When I vaccinate, I have a little cooler that I put the vaccines in. Observe the proper withdrawal times. We already mentioned it's 21 days for a lot of them, but be sure to check the label. If an animal does have a reaction to a vaccine, and that can happen, if you have epinephrine on hand, not only for vaccinations, but any time an animal might react to something, that's a good thing to have on hand. Discard unused vaccine. That gets back to the person who asked the question about buying it new every year. You really should. Within the same year, I'd probably be more practical, but from year to year, I would. Write down what you use. Keep a record of it. Just like all medications, keep a record of it. Here's what you don't do. Don't vaccinate a wet or dirty animal. Don't vaccinate a sick animal. They're not going to have a very good immune response. As already mentioned, do not vaccinate your pregnant mom within 14 days of lambing or kidding. She's not going to be able to get that immunity into the colostrum. Also previously mentioned, don't vaccinate ideally. I know sometimes you might feel like you have to, but the very young animals, because of their immature immune systems, are not going to respond. Don't give vaccinations in the high price cut areas. Again, one, they are subcutaneous injections. They go under the skin. Makes no sense to stick them in the leg and loin, anyhow, even if it's an animal that you don't think is ever going to be in the food chain. The places to give them, I kind of like that little armpit, the axilla, high up on the neck, over the ribs. Some of it's personal preference, some of it's species differences, some of it's handling, you know, what part of the animal is presented to you the easiest. There can be different recommendations. You know, I've seen some not even consider over the ribs. You know, they get more particular on where they want you to give them, okay? But the basic idea is we're looking for loose skin, and we're not wanting to put it in a high-price cut area. We don't want you to mix vaccines. Now, there's some vaccines out there in the world that require a mixing. What I mean is don't mix two different ones together. Why might it not work? You vaccinated and it didn't work. You gave the wrong vaccine. You gave the toxoid instead of the antitoxin. You gave the wrong dose. You gave it wrong. You gave it at the wrong time. You vaccinated at the wrong age. Might not work. You only gave one CD&T shot, not the second one. You didn't store it properly. You used vaccine from 2 years ago. You contaminated your equipment, and you vaccinated unhealthy animals. Those are all reasons why vaccines might not work. And even when you do everything perfect, they are not perfect. Sometimes a disease challenge can be so overwhelming that even a vaccination program might fall short. It's not likely, but it's possible. The bottom line is you probably all want to ask, each one of you ask yourself, should I vaccinate at all? Obviously, we talked about which ones to vaccinate, but why would you vaccinate for any particular disease? And what I want you to understand is what vaccination is. It's not a guarantee. It's not a requirement. It's a way for you to manage the disease risk on your farm with your animals. It's part of your whole health management plan, or can be part of it. You want to prevent diseases if you can. You want to control diseases if you can. Where the disease risk is real high, you know, you're in a wooded area and they just killed a rabid raccoon. Guess what? I think your rabies risk might be pretty high. Okay? Basically, vaccines are insurance. Not in the long run, but in the long run. You don't vaccinate for overeating disease and you don't lose any animals for 5 years. That sixth year, you lose quite a few of them. So you're looking at the long run, and ultimately, the cost of vaccinating, and cost means the vaccine itself, the time you spend giving it, and the tissue damage that you get has to be less than what you think you'd lose. The other reason it might come in handy, or reason to do it, is to increase the value of your livestock. If I sell breeding stock, I would much rather buy vaccinated stock. Kind of like if you think of feeder cattle, they have special sales, and feeder calves are more valuable if they've been preconditioned, and one of the aspects of preconditioning is vaccination. So they feel like they get a better quality animal, so it might increase the value. Why might I not vaccinate? Well, I might not vaccinate if I consider my disease risk to be really, really, really low. Like, I'm not going to vaccinate for, I got to give you an example, sore mouth. I'm not going to vaccinate on my place for sore mouth. Well, first of all, I don't have it, and I don't ever think I'm going to get it. I think my risk is really low. Like other clostridial diseases, I'm not going to vaccinate for them because I'm not going to say it's not possible. I just think the probability is really low. The cost is more than the loss, or what I perceive the loss could potentially be. The cost is too high. The other reason, and this is one I have to grapple with sometimes, is if you're not going to do it right, don't do it. I always do a good job vaccinating my ewes. I always get the first vaccination for CD&T into the lambs. But I'll admit it, I haven't always gotten the second one into them. So I started thinking, well, if I'm not going to do it right, should I do it? What I really should say is I should do it right. I should get two of them in it. But if you're not going to do it right, don't do it. If you insist on giving a CD&T vaccine to a two-day-old lamb, don't do it. You know? Only do it if you're going to do it right. The tissue damage that we can get from vaccines, they are common, and they're more common with some vaccines than the other. And some of it has to do with how you vaccinate, you know, you being clean and sanitary and changing needles and protecting the integrity of that bottle of vaccine. That certainly has something to do with whether you're going to get a vaccination or not. I can tell you some years, I feel like I do it the same every year, but some years I get more knots than others. One of the reasons I like giving a vaccination in the armpit is so that if it does develop any kind of knot, it's not visible. For example, our buck test, we don't allow abscesses, or we're going to test for abscesses. So if I see a knot up on the neck because they gave a vaccine up there, which is very common, it's probably not CL, but I don't know that for a fact. If it's in the armpit, it's going to be better, or if I'm going to show, I'm going to put them down there. But we're going to get some abscesses, and some vaccines are going to be worse than others. And like I said, the best thing you can do is to be clean and sanitary with all the things we talked about. But even then, you're probably going to get some. And you may try a different brand of vaccine if you think they're too excessive and you did everything right. So I went a few minutes over, and for that I apologize.